All right, I want to pick up on another Lewis structure. This one's going to be for water, since it's one of the most important substances on the earth. First of all, look at the substance and determine whether it's ionic or covalent or molecular. And it's a hydrogen is a nonmetal and oxygen is a nonmetal, so this is a molecular substance or a covalent substance. So again, we're going to have covalent bonding between the hydrogen and the oxygen. So the next thing you need to do is add up your total number of valence electrons in this molecule. So we have two hydrogens. Each hydrogen has one valence electron, and then we have one oxygen, which has six valence electrons. And when we add that together, we get 8. Now hydrogen, even though it's less electronegative than oxygen, hydrogen can never be the central atom. So the oxygen is the central atom, and we know that at least one bond occurs between the hydrogen and the oxygen, like so. So we've used up 4 of our electrons, 2 in this bond, 2 in this bond, and we have 4 electrons still to place, and we know that those need to go on the oxygen so that the oxygen follows the octet rule. So oxygen has 8 electrons around it, hydrogen has 2 electrons. Now that's all hydrogen needs. There are exceptions to the octet rule. Hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, these elements are all going to have less than the octet rule for the most part. And the reason why is if you look at most of these, they start off with one shell, and the first shell can only hold 2 electrons. Lithium actually has 2 shells, but it loses this electron to get a full outer shell of 2, which is again like helium. So these same thing with beryllium. Beryllium has 2 and 2, and it loses these 2 and gets a full outer shell of 2. Boron's a little different. Boron a lot of times is satisfied with six valence electrons. It'll form 3 bonds. Alright, so hydrogen doesn't follow the octet rule, but oxygen definitely does. So the next thing we need to be able to do is to determine what type of bond is occurring between the hydrogen and oxygen. Is it covalent, polar covalent, or ionic? Well, we know the electronegativity of oxygen is 3.5. And the electronegativity of hydrogen is 2.1, so 3.5 minus 2.1 gives us 1.4, and that's between 0 and 2.1. So we're dealing with polar covalent bonds. All right. So we would put a partially negative on the oxygen and a partially positive on the hydrogens. There is no resonance here. There's no way we can redraw this structure, follow the Lewis structure rules, and come up with some different structure. So the next thing we need to do is we need to use a valence shell, electron pair repulsion theory, and start trying to figure out what the geometry of this is. So the first thing we do is we look at the oxygen. And coming off the oxygen are 2 bonding pairs. So we got X2. Here's one bonding pair, here's the other bonding pair. And then we have 2 non-bonding pairs. We represent that by E2. Now your book has a table in 3.5. It talks about bonding and non-bonding pairs. I just think it's easier to write it like this as some type of formula called the classification. A stands for the central atom, X stands for the bonding pairs coming off the central atom, and E stands for the non-bonding pairs coming off the central atom. So the question is, how do you keep 4 things as far away from each other as possible? Now when I ask most students this, they say, oh yeah, this is easy. You make it like this, or maybe like this, and then put the lone pair out this way and the lone pair out this way, and you get like a cross here. But we got to think in 3 dimensions. The angle between here and here would only be 90 degrees, but there is a way to arrange these bonding and non-bonding pairs so that they have a greater angle than 90 degrees. So how do we do that? We put the oxygen in the middle, hydrogen here, we have a lone pair coming out of the board or out of the screen at you, and we have a lone pair going back through the screen like so. Dashed line means back through the plane. Triangle means coming out at you. And the angle then is actually 100, and it's actually a little less than 109.5. If it was a true tetrahedral, that's the geometry, the framework geometry, then it would be 109.5. But these lone pairs, they are so repulsive, they actually force these bonding pairs closer together. And so the angle is less than 109.5. All right, so the framework is tetrahedral. When four things are coming off the central atom, the best framework geometry is tetrahedral. Now, the actual geometry of the molecule is what you can see with the bonding pairs. So we say this is bent. Another word is angular. And I've also heard it called nonlinear, although I think that one you don't hear as much. So you only look at this part to determine the geometry of the molecule. I'm never going to ask you for the framework geometry, like tetrahedral for this, but you have to do the framework geometry in order to get the geometry correctly. All my questions will be based on what is the geometry or shape, and then for this case, it would be bent or angular or nonlinear. Alright, next thing you need to be able to do is put the partial negative here, put the partial positives on the hydrogens. Again, what's happening here is the electrons are being pulled towards the oxygen because it's more electronegative. Now, there is a way to draw an imaginary line right through here, strictly positive on this side, here and here, and strictly negative on the other side. Because the molecule itself has a positive and negative end to it, we call this a polar molecule. Now, again, do not get this confused with polar covalent bond. When we're talking about bonds, we're talking about the bonds between the hydrogen and oxygen. When we say a polar molecule, we're saying the molecule itself has a positive and negative end to it. This is really important because this is what determines why oil does not dissolve in water. Oil is nonpolar, water is polar, and they don't dissolve in each other. The rule of thumb is like dissolves like. If you want to dissolve something polar, you've got to have something polar. If you want to dissolve something like oil, which is nonpolar, you're going to have to use a nonpolar substance. That's why people clean their hands with kerosene, or I've seen people clean their hands with gasoline. I don't recommend that at all. But I have seen that, and it's because nonpolar dissolves nonpolar and polar dissolves polar. So that's what we're ultimately trying to get out of chapter 3, is for you to be able to take a chemical formula, come up with the Lewis structure, determine what type of bonds you have. In order to have any chance of a molecule being polar, you must have polar covalent bonds. But just as important as the polar covalent bonds is the correct geometry. A geometry that allows the partially positive charges to be on one side of a line and the partially negative to be on the other side of the line. I hope this helps, and if you have further questions, email me.